ArcadePerfect, my Arse.
Okay guys, welcome to another ArcadePerfect, my Arse. This week's game is the classic Final Fight. Let's go for a one-player game. Now obviously you can see here, you've got the choice of three players. Let's go for this bloke, or this guy as I should say. Now what made this game a real standout game was the graphics. I mean, the graphics are just stunning. The backgrounds, the size of sprites. I can always remember seeing this in the arcades. And, you know, I was just absolutely blown away with the size of the sprites. It does always look like the game has been stretched slightly, but this is exactly how it looked in the arcades. Big, tall, lanky guys. And there's a lot going on as well on the screen. I'm getting absolutely knifed to death here. Super fast paced, and what really made this game excellent as well is it had the simultaneous two player option. I'm just going to move this up a wee bit, slightly off center. A bit better. Now let's continue. But yeah, I mean, this game came out after Double Dragon. I'm not quite sure how long after. Probably only maybe a year or so. But it really ramped up the graphics still. I mean, this game had a lot of spawned a lot of similar games. Cadillacs and Dinosaurs, Captain Commando, I think, as well. Although to be fair, accolade probably went to Double Dragon, because it started this whole kind of two player beat 'em up, scrolling beat 'em up. But Capcom really knew. I mean, it was basically, I think this game came out after Street Fighter 2, I might be talking rubbish, but they almost use this sort of graphic style from Street Fighter in these games. But it's a truly awesome game. Hello! Deary me, it certainly gets filled up with characters. Yeah, now it's not often that I criticise arcade games. One thing about this game is, because the graphics are so big and there's so many kind of players on the screen at once, it can get slightly congested. I could certainly say it would benefit having a slightly larger play area. But then that's just me being bloody picky. I've never seen a telephone box like that inside a railway station, I must admit. Although I dare say they do exist. Right, anyway, listen guys, that is enough of that. That is the arcade one. That is Final Fight. Let's take a look at some home conversions. Okay, this is Atari ST one. Certainly looks really nice. And again, you've got the option of three players. Or three characters, I should say. Let's go for Hagar. Oh, blimey, what's going on here? Hey, well, the graphics are certainly big enough, that's for sure. This guy's taking up almost the whole screen. Now I'm running this under emulation on my MAME cab. For some reason I could not get it to work on the PC at all. Well, you certainly can't fault the ambition of this version. Massive graphics. I would say they're almost as bloody bigger than the arcade ones. You can see, obviously scrolling's not the best. And it runs a wee bit slow, but then that's to be expected. When you take into consideration the hardware of the Atari ST compared to the CPS2 or something it was called, that Capcom are using for these games. I mean, this isn't a bad version at all. There's lack of colour slightly, it's a bit too kind of browny for my liking, but that's just down to probably is it 16 colours or something in the screen at that. There appears to be a complete lack of sound as well, apart from the music. I'm not sure if you've got the option to change that. Come here, bald bloke. But yeah, this is—it's not bad. It's a credible attempt. You know, there are a lot of god-awful arcade conversions on the Amiga and the Atari ST. And I'd have to say that this isn't one of them, this is actually quite a competent version. Again, they could have probably gone for a slightly smaller sprite and allowed a bit more on screen. I mean, look at the size of these guys, I mean, my goodness. I mean, on this monitor that I'm playing, I mean, the sprite must be, I don't know, a good 5 inches high or something. It's huge. Now, you can see there, at the very top right, it says press fire, so obviously this had a simultaneous two-player version as well, which was handy. I'm not sure how that would work on a screen this size or enough, but... But nah, all in all, this is quite impressive, all things considered. Anyway, listen guys, this is the Atari ST version. Let's crack on.
Okay, this is the ZX Spectrum version. Now, interestingly, this game only appears to have been released on the 128 version. It doesn't appear to have ever been the one on the 48K one. Not quite sure why that was. It certainly seems to be missing a big chunk of the marketplace back then. I mean, the 48K was obviously massively, massively popular, and there wasn't quite so many folk with the 128 version. So anyway, let's try and get into this. Come on, start. Come on, space. Come on, what's happening? Let's go. Are we getting there? Hello, what's happening? Oh, there we go. Right, blimey. Well, dearie me, that's quite a surprise. Graphically, I mean, the actual static graphics are quite phenomenal looking. I mean, look at the detail. It's obviously running in a very, very high res resolution. Sound is obviously pretty minimal. Now, I mean, the graphics, static graphics are actually very, very detailed. Again, it's monochrome, but that's just what happened with the Spectrum. It's not the quickest, it's quite slow. That's the thing with the Spectrum, they never do anything in halves. I mean, if you looked at the Commodore 64 one, you could see they just tried to take the essence of the game and made it playable within the confines of the hardware, but the Spectrum always seemed to just kind of really go for the proper graphics, and it's certainly done that here. I mean, these are super detailed, and I'm actually quite astonished that it's running, even running remotely. I mean, it's the fact it's running at all is it's quite incredible. It's not the quickest, and I mean, there's not a hell of a lot of frames of animation. Dustbin, and is Dustbin then? Is that the name of the guy, or is that an actual? And they're talking about the Dustbin, right? I'm guessing it must actually be the Dustbin itself. Yeah, it is. It's quite incredible that this game's even running. Knife. So it actually strategically tells you what each thing is. Alright, let's go. Are we going to go downstairs? Yep. There we go. Right, I noticed there's no end of level baddie. You don't get that big dreadlocked character like you do in other versions. Now, you can see there, the frames per second, the frame rate isn't the greatest. But that's because they're running super high res graphics. And this is an 8-bit Spectrum. I mean, there's two trains of thought with me with this. You could either go for a reduced game, have smaller graphics and make it more playable, or you could try and go for the full Booner, which they've always attempted to do here. So, it's quite interesting. Anyway, listen guys, I think that's long enough. That is the ZX Spectrum version. Okay then, this is a final fight, and this is on the Nintendo Game Boy Advance. Now, I did actually own this cartridge, and if I remember rightly, it's rather spiffing. So this came out 2001. Now, yep, you can actually link up as well.
Ha ha.
Yeah, this is just as I remember. I remember being really impressed with this when I got it back in 2001 or whenever it was. All the sound effects, it's got a musical track. Certainly doesn't seem to suffer from any slowdown. And as you'll notice, at the start there, as I pointed out, it's also got a, you could actually connect up two Gameboy Advances for some multiplayer shenanigans. This game would have looked even better on the small Game Boy Advance screen. So yeah, this is an excellent version, it really is. I mean, in defence of other systems, other versions, they all came out much earlier on. Excuse me. Obviously the Game Boy Advance is infinitely more powerful than 8-bit versions that we had back in the day. But then this feature is all about taking a look at all the versions to see what I reckon is the best one. This is actually a better version than the SNES one, because it's got the three characters, and if you've got a pal that's got the game and another Game Boy Advance, then you could have some linked up two-player action. But yep, graphics look spot on, maybe slightly less colours than the arcade had, but it's nevertheless really impressive. But the gangs back in the 90s had some really, really dodgy fashion. Seriously. One of the guys getting beat up walking about. This is Luke Skywalker. And this, of course, they're all off to cosplay events. It's just a possibility. Wesley Snipes here. Oof! Okay, so it's got its own little kind of cutscenes as well.
What?
Ah, game over. And listen guys, that is the Game Boy Advance version. It's excellent.
Okay, this is the Commodore Amiga one. And again, you've got the option for the three players. Let's go for Guy. Now this actually looks pretty tasty. Big graphics. Not quite sure what the money gives you. Yeah, and it actually, it's got a bit more colour than the ST one, and it's nice and quick as well, and the scrolling is nice and smooth. And again, it's got the two-player option. Graphics are pretty authentic to the arcade one. Again, slight lacky colour, but that's to be expected. One monkey boy. He looks like a kind of Japanese Buddha. Well, that'd be because he's called Wong Bu. Or Wong Hu even. Yeah, this is a nice version. And I'm glad to see that it's not just been a straightforward port of ST one. It certainly plays quite a bit better, it's quicker. Yeah, I mean, look at this. This really does look good. I do remember playing this one a lot back in the day. This was the computer of choice that I had back in whenever it was, 1991 or something. Interestingly, he didn't sit on the. He usually sits on the wee kind of step and whistles for his pals, but he didn't appear to do that in this version. But nah, this is a very, very credible version. Certainly quick as well. There's no slowdown at all. Whoa, sweet child of mine. What's going on there? That's surely unfair. Obviously the home computer versions only had the one fire button. So standing still, punches, and moving the joystick to the side so it does a flying kick. I'm not quite sure how you actually kick. Okay, right, that's enough of this one. This is some nice spot effects as well. That's the Commodore Amiga one, guys. Let's crack on.
Right then, this is the C64 one. Where do we start? Okay, right, let's see. Right, we can pick one of three players. Let's go for the dude with the white t-shirt, because that looks most like me. Okay. Right, so you've got punch. You got a kick, maybe the spacebar? No, it doesn't appear. Right. What can I say about this game? It looks like a Commodore 64 one. Now, it's rather than try and go for the huge, big arcade graphics like the Amstrad one did, it's gone for a more... what's the word for it? It's going for a better word. It's going for smaller graphics. More modest, that's what I was looking for. It's going for more sort of modest graphics. It's, you know, I mean, to try and push around huge big sprites on an 8-bit system just isn't going to work. Now, I must admit, I've never actually played the C64 version of this. I've never played any of the 8-bit versions until I started making this feature. I had moved on to the, I think I was up to the Amiga at this point, so I had no interest, or indeed I didn't have any way of playing the 8-bit versions. It's alright, I suppose. I mean, it's what you'd expect. What's happening here? We've got a poltergeist in our midst, I think we have. Because that door just opened all on its own. Yeah, it's a typical Commodore 64 port. Blocky graphics and a lot of greys and browns. It's actually quite hard to... When there's two brown guys on the screen at once, it's quite hard to actually figure out what one you are. What's interesting is that Cody, who I am, has a white t-shirt, and yet he miraculously changes to a brown t-shirt in this one. Sounds... Obviously there's no music, I don't think there's any music in the arcade one, to be fair. Obviously sounds just a few spot effects, punching. I don't think you can kick. Can you kick in this game? You can do a flying kick with holding down the fire button and sort of moving the joystick to the side. It doesn't really feel much like Final Fight. I don't really know what I was expecting. I don't really know what more you could expect. It's too many browns in this version for my liking. There must be some way to kick. Ah, bollocks. Sorry about that. Stupid. I shouldn't go pressing keys when I'm recording one of these things. Because it just looks silly when things like that come up. Anyway, yep, this is... I'm getting a bit bored of this one already. If there's a bit more colour, it would have been nicer. I mean, the graphics themselves aren't too bad. But it's just too many greys and too many browns. Let's play it for one more minute to see if we can... If anything else is going to happen. At least he's in red. That's a... I'll give it that. Anyways, like I said, I don't know if you can actually... If you can, kick. Now, I see there, you can obviously have simultaneous... Oops, is there a spinning kick there? You can have simultaneous two players, which is quite good, I suppose. Big dude. Oh, there's a knife. Right, anyway, listen guys, that is a C64 one. It's alright, it's just, it's a bit lacky colour for my liking. But, I mean, it plays alright, it's quite responsive. Not sure, too sure how you kick. Anyway, let's crack on, guys. Okay, this is the Sharp X68000 version. Now, I've been reliably informed by a few people that the Sharp X68000 actually is identical hardware to, was it the CP, what's the name of the software? It was basically the hardware that Capcom used in their arcade games was identical to this computer. So that is why this computer gets absolutely perfect versions of the games. I mean, this is just an absolute stunning version. It even utilises some two fire buttons as well. Maybe more fire buttons, I'm not too sure. But seeing games like this just make me want a sharp X60,000 or the more, but I know it's virtually impossible to pick one of these machines up. And getting them to run games is probably nigh on impossible. I think they're extortionate at the games as well, so I'll just have to make do with emulators. But this is an absolutely amazing version. You'd have been everybody's best pal at school if you had one of these back in the day. Yeah, this is an absolute staggering version, it really is. It's just so quick, so responsive. Apparently the only thing, I did read about a wee bit about this version, apparently the only thing that differs this from the arcade one is one of the versions used a MIDI soundtrack and the other one used a non-MIDI soundtrack, if that makes any sense. Now I'm not too sure what one's what, but I mean, the sound sounds brilliant on this one. Sound samples are absolutely crystal clear. I'd probably see this actually edges the arcade one, because it's obviously been, I'm guessing, the difficulty's been slightly toned down since it's a home version. So I'm going to go for one quick more wee shot of this one. And you can see there it says push start, so again this version had the simultaneous two player as well, so this is an absolute stunning conversion. But then I say I'm calling it a conversion, it's really, it is the arcade one you're really playing, because it's the same hardware. Come to me, ladies. Looking dudes in big Elvis Presley outfits.
Yeah.
meant to say, guys, if anybody's interested in any of the emulators that I run these games on, let me know. I mean, most of them are pretty easily downloadable from just Google them, but if you're wanting links to that, just let me know. I mean, all these emulators are obviously free to use. I'm quite happy to share the links if anyone's interested. But what I might actually do, I know one of my subscribers did actually ask that I could do a wee feature on the emulators that I use. I'm quite happy to do that. Right, anyway, I'm getting carried away with this. This is excellent. This is absolutely fantastic. That is the Sharp X60,000 version. Okay, guys, this is the Amstrad CPC 464 version. Now, these intro bits seem to drag on and on and on and on. There doesn't appear to be any way to skip them, at least I can't find it. So I'm just going to pause the video in between so we can kind of speed things up. But you can see there, it looks nice. It's got quite a nice sort of presentation. The music's not too bad either. So I'm just going to pause this now. You can see there it's got this little sort of intro as well, good use of the red colour. Right, let's just skip to the actual gameplay. As I say, this is a disc version I'm using, I couldn't get the tape one to work and it seems to drag on and on, you kind of seem to skip it, so I'm just going to pause it now and cut right to the actual game itself. Right, okay, you do actually get to select what character you want. You can press the escape button. In fact, let's just have a quick look. See what the next one is. Right, let's try and go for him. Right, okay, we're now in the game. Right, you can see I am Cody. Now, what's quite surprising with this game is it's trying to utilise the huge, big, massive graphics of the arcade. They obviously look a bit odd with, you know, running with fewer colours. It's also a bit slow. Now, I'd imagine they'd have been better off, instead of trying to go for the duplicate the actual colours and also the size of sprites, go for smaller sprites, which would have worked a lot better. I'm doing a lot of jumping about here, but not a lot of punching. Yeah, it's all running a wee bit too slow. I'm trying to see if you can actually get more than one sort of enemy on the screen at once. The problem with this is it makes for a very small playing area. Saying that, I mean, the arcade one, that's, you know, the playing area is not that much bigger. Right, I appear to have killed that guy. Ah, well, there you go, you've now got two guys on the screen at once, so that's quite impressive, I guess. Sound is minimal, as you can probably tell. Right, I appear to... Oh, I seem to be kicking them now. Yeah, it's... it's just been a wee bit too over ambitious, I think. They would have been far better going for smaller sprites, sort of like Target Renegade type thing. They've really tried to go for the big sprites of the arcade. It's a commendable effort, but it's just a bit... Thing is, when I'm doing these Arcade Perfect features, I'm always aware I'm only playing the game for 3 minutes. Now, as we all know, as video gamers, you can't always tell how good a game is after 3 minutes. I mean, there's games that I've tried and I've not got on with, but other people reckon they're great games. You know, the games do have a bit of depth and you have to kind of get used to the controls to really get anything out of it. So I mean, you do have to appreciate when I'm playing these games, I'm only playing them for a very short period of time, so I may unfairly see a game is pretty rubbish, and it may be alright if you actually sort of get into it. It's a good attempt at the arcade, big graphics, but it's just that wee bit too slow, and it looks that bit too messy. They look like the graphics just look a bit rubbish. They've really tried, they would have been better off just trying to go for a cut down version of it. So anyway, listen, that's enough of this one. This is the Amstrad CPC 4641. Okay then, this is the Super Nintendo version. Now this, interestingly, was actually a launch title for this NES. I think it came out in Japan first, was it 1990, something like that. Now, the one big failing of this version was due to hardware limitations. Apparently it could only display so many sprites on the screen at once, although not sprites but graphics. It removed the two player option, which was obviously a big thing for the SNES version. They also removed one of the characters. I think, was it Guy? Was he the one that was taken out? Let's have a wee look. Yeah, you've got Cody, you've got Hagar, but the guy, the dude with the red suit, which is Guy, I think, he was left out. They did bring out a sort of follow-up to this. They called it Final Fight 2, which was not entirely true. It was basically, I think they replaced Cody with Guy, so you still only had the two players, but you could then play as the other one. But I don't think they ever did actually put a two-player option in. Now the thing that I always find quite surprising with the SNES, I always think of the SNES as being a more powerful console than the Sega Mega Drive, but apparently the processor on the SNES was a lot slower, and it meant that like sort of sprite-based games like this actually ran quite a bit slower, so that's probably why there's fewer enemies in this version than the other versions. It still looks really nice. I mean, if I was 16 years old and I was back in 1990 and I got this for my Christmas, I'd have been absolutely over the moon. Although I suppose I would have been a wee bit disappointed that my pal couldn't play at the same time. I mean, graphically wise, it looks really nice. Sprites are big. Nice use of colour, really, really sharp graphics. Again, I would say the only slight criticism, apart from the obvious, lack of two-player options, is they've gone for the big graphics, but the actual sort of gameplay area is quite small. Quite sure with some nifty programming they could have probably put the two-player mode in. But then, you know, I don't know. A lot of people probably wouldn't be too bothered about not having a two-player mode, but it would have been nice to have that option. What's a wee bit disappointing is he doesn't so much jump between the areas, he just vanishes. It does almost seem to me as if this version was slightly rushed to try and get it out for the console launch. I mean, what they've got in is excellent, but there's just a few wee shortcuts, which just kind of takes away from the overall experience of the game. It would have been interesting had this come out in the Mega Drive. I don't mean the Mega CD, but the actual Mega Drive itself. If it had the two-player option, that would have provided a bit of interesting competition back in the day. Yeah, I mean, this version, I would say it's like 85% excellent, and it's just lacking a couple of things. I mean, there's no real notable slowdown, but that's probably just because they have reduced the number of baddies. Oh! I think that sprite was taken straight for you. Street Fighter myself. Now watch this, you'll just go bing! And there we go, round clear. Right, anyway guys, listen, that's enough for this one. That is the Super Nintendo one. Okay then, this is
a well-known crime capital,
the Mega CD version.
Violence and death for many years. A fact which the newly elected mayor and former Street Fighter Mike Hager plans to change. At the center of the problem is the huge...
You can see there, they've obviously overlaid about speech, which wasn't in the original one.
Criminal activity in the city. When they learned of Hager's plans, took immediate action to bring this new mayor under their control.
Let's skip this bit. So this is obviously being added in.
Sometime in
right, let's see if we can actually get any meat and bones of the game.
Mike Hager here.
Mr. Hager. So pleased to make
sounds like the same guy doing all the voices.
I believe you know who I am. Don't hang up. We have a little business.
Come on, how do we skip this? We must be able to skip it, surely.
And we'll throw in the regular monthly bonus to your salary we offered before.
What? What happened to Jessica? Who is this?
Not so
right, and I'm going to pause it, guys, to see if I can get to the actual action.
Listen to reason, man.
Oh, Mike's looking angry, look.
Just let us do as we please. Like them sweethearts.
Oh, Jesus, it gets better.
The Mad Gear must pay. She's my friend, too. Count me in.
Right. Now then, can we start? Right, why doesn't it want us to start? Come on. Well, are we in? Getting in now? Right, hooray! Obviously the presentation's top notch, the acting's pish, but anyway. Sounds excellent, as you can hear there. Right, let's go for Ken, or whatever his name is. He's obviously pinched Ken's uniform. Now interestingly, this game was never ported for the Mega Drive. Obviously it had its own take in this game with Streets of Rage, which a lot of Mega Drive owners reckon is better than this game. But it's interesting why it was actually missed off. I mean, unless was it because Nintendo got an exclusive license to it? That's a possibility. This one looks really nice. Music's excellent. Notice it's slightly jerky. Just being a bit Mr. Nitpicky from Knitsville, but yeah, it is slightly jerky. But nothing to write home about. There's a big McDonald's, that'll do me. But the sound is particularly good in this one. Interesting, he had to back off there before he could then go down the stairs. I thought he was going to do a front somersault or something. Let's pick up the large pipe and bludgeon a few people. Oops! And somebody fix that light when you're at it, it's flickering badly. Yeah, this one's pretty spot on. Sounds excellent. But yeah, I'm still quite intrigued as to why the Mega Drive never got a version of this. Yeah, the Mega CD. It eventually came out the Mega CD. Strange. This is unless Nintendo had exclusive rights on the SNES for a short time, don't know. It's amazing what you find underneath stacks of tires. But yep, graphics are spot on, sounds excellent, music's really good. It's actually not irritating, which is quite a common thing in sort of 90s brawlers. It's usually your rock kind of stuff. Seem to be one of the must-have games for the Mega CD, and these were quite thin in the ground, I have to admit. I've actually got a Mega CD, I got it on a car boot sale about 4 years ago, and I think I used it once. Admit he's not putting up a tremendous struggle here, is he? Well, man, how come his energy appears to have gone up? Fat boy, take him. Certainly plenty of action on screen. Right, anyway, listen, that's plenty. We're running way over with this one. This is the Mega CD version, that's excellent.
Okay guys, this is the very, very, very final version of Final Fight. This is on the original Xbox, and again, it was released as part of the Capcom Classics Collection, which is an absolutely awesome collection. It's also available for the PS2, PSP, and the Xbox. Turn that up a wee bit, so you can hear it. Now, I'm guessing it's going to be like all the other games that are on this compilation, insofar as it's actually emulating the arcade. So it's going to play spot on. And spot on, it does play. I must admit, can you imagine if like the Xbox technology was available in 1990. I mean, having, when these games are out in the arcade, having a platform that could play it, play them absolutely perfectly, you'd have been the most popular kid in the school. I mean, you really would. The sad thing is, by the time these compilations came out on the Xbox, people had moved on to, you know, next generation games. People weren't really interested in playing games like this, apart from the sort of retro heads like ourselves. But yeah, this plays just perfect. And obviously you've got the two-player option as well. And I'm getting absolutely shit kicked out of me at the moment. Now, I'm sure there is some sort of special move which I have yet to find out. I must admit I've never really played this game for any length of time. That's something I really should rectify though. For all it's an amazing looking game, I've always found these games pretty much a bit too samey for my liking. There's not a lot of depth in the game. And that's why they'd probably make, it was Vin Diesel, they'd probably make way better arcade games, let's continue, than home versions. Because it's all about grabbing the person with the graphics, getting them to put money in. But as far as a long term sort of longevity game, not too sure about this. But I mean, the sound and the graphics are just awesome, they really are. Quite sure what that guy with the leopard vest and the chains is all about. And the less said about his dodgy haircut, the better. Andor Jr. Anyway, listen, I think I've played enough of this one. That is the Xbox. Whoops, I've just disconnected the controller. We don't want to... Sorry about that, guys. A minute. I'll just let that run in the background. Come on, what's going on? Yeah, okay, guys. That is it. That is the final version of Final Fight. So then, let's see, to recap. We've looked at quite a few versions. ZX Spectrum, super high-res graphics, really detailed graphics, quite impressive actually, really, really ambitious version. The downside to the Spectrum one, it was it would only play in a 128 Spectrum. It was quite slow because of the detailed graphics, and it only had one player as well. Which was a shame, but yeah, really ambitious. I mean, they could have gone for a sort of cut down version, but they chose to go for the full Booner. So yeah, good attempt to the Spectrum. Game Boy Advance, fantastic game. I mean, I played that a lot back in the day. It looks great on the Game Boy Advance screen, especially if you've got a back sort of lit console. It's got really nice graphics, great sound, arcade perfect almost. It's also got a two-player link-up as long as you've got two copies of the games and two Game Boy Advances, obviously. So yeah, that's a fantastic version. Commodore 64. Really, really blocky expanded sprites, which is a typical, which has got a common thing in the C64. Very, very dull looking, lacky colour. I know a lot of Spectrum owners slag the C64 for different colours of brown, and I have to say it's a very brown game. It does have the two-player option, so get it right up, you Spectrum. Good attempt. It's pretty much what I would expect for the C64. The Sharp X68000. What can I say? Absolutely fantastic version. I would say the graphics look even better than the arcade. It's that good. I couldn't fault it in any shape or form. It's got two-player. It's fast. It looks amazing. Fantastic sound. Can't say any more than that. Amstrad, they've kind of gone a halfway house. They've gone for a kind of halfway between the Spectrum and Commodore. They've gone for the big graphics, quite colourful, much more colourful than the C64, but it's just too slow, which is unfortunate. But a good attempt. Super Nintendo looks really nice graphically, plays well. Lack of characters on screen, probably just down to the sort of the processor speed. The big downside for the SNES version is it's only got a one-player option. You can't have two players, simultaneous two-player options, and you've only got the two characters to pick from as well. They did bring out a follow-up to that, as I mentioned when I was looking at the SNES one, where you could play as a different character, but it was still only two characters, and you could still only play as one player. So that was a bit of a shame. Mega CD, that was really quite impressive. Great graphics, fantastic sound, really liked the music. Because it's obviously CD, they'd introduced speech as well, which the arcade one didn't have. But top-notch game, two-player as well, so really good version. The Atari ST and Amiga were very, very similar. Both had good graphics, slightly better colour on the Amiga one. Good gameplay in them all. The Atari ST frame rate wasn't that great, so that would certainly knock that one down a few points. The Amiga one, though, I would say it had better colour, better use of colour, more colour, and it was super fast and it looked the part. So that was really, really good. Quite impressed with that. And very last, but by no means least, is the one we're looking at just now. That's running on the original Xbox. Again, it's emulated, so it's kind of cheating slightly, but there you go. So that's it, guys. My top three. It's quite a tough one. There's quite a few poor versions. The 8-bit versions, really, there was nothing to write home about. None of them were particularly standout. The 16-bit versions, the Amiga one, certainly is worthy of a mention. It's a good version, quite authentic. But in third place, I'm going to go for the Game Boy Advance. Really nice version, you know, perfect two-player option. It's handheld as well, what more can you ask for? In second place, it's got to be the Mega CD. That's really, really nice, really authentic. It says great graphics, two-player option as well. But there was only going to be one winner in this one when I saw that version, and that no surprise, is the Sharp X68000. Can't say any more about it. Unbelievable version. Having played the arcade one as well, I would say that the Sharp X68000 is the better one, and again, apparently it's because it was using the same hardware as the arcade version. So yeah, in gold medal position is the Sharp X68000. That is it. That is them all final fighted out. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. Please feel free to leave any comments. If you want to subscribe, then that would be utterly fantastic. You can follow me on Twitter, as usual, guys, under Mamemeister. And that's about all I have to say in the matter. If you want to see any particular game featured in the Arcade Perfect, please pop it in the comments below, guys. And as usual, I hope you enjoy watching.